talk about Dartmouth Health Education. Please do take a seat and welcome to you.
So, hi everyone. So, you can hear me? Okay, thank you. So, I didn't expect so many people today, so quite a lot of pressure. So, my name is Florence Blanc-Renaud, and I am working as a senior software engineer in a free IPA team. So, it is a team that is responsible for identity management products inside Red Hat. But during the half hour that we'll spend together, I will try to take a different role. So I will imagine that I am, for instance, a sysadmin who is wanting to protect his resources. So I do not want everyone to access my machine, my systems, or I do not want everyone to be able to see all the web pages and so on. So my first statement is that we are living on in a world that is relying on passwords. So if you try to count how many passwords you are using in your day-to-day life, you are probably using one for your email, maybe you have a Facebook account, Twitter, LinkedIn. So I can go on. And we have too many passwords to remember. So if I want to protect my systems with another password, what does it imply for the users? So the first consequence of all those many passwords is that user will simply try to pick a password that will be easy to remember. So, they pick at least the password, but if the password is easy to remember, it means also that it will be easy to steal. So every year we see such news in the newspapers. So accounts for which passwords are stolen. So you remember, I am a sysadmin, I want to protect everything. So if we can steal my password when they are easy, I need to take some measures to counter that. So I will try to harden the password policy, for instance. I will decide, for instance, that all the passwords must have a specific length, maybe 8, 10, or more characters. I will ask my users to rotate their password more oftenly. I can also keep track of the password policy, the password history, and I can also impose to use various character classes. So for instance, uppercase, lowercase, then I want also to see numbers or special characters in the password. So now I am confident that the password will be more difficult to guess. But what is the consequence? The consequence is that the hackers will not try to brute force attack the password, but instead of that, they will try social engineering, for instance, phishing, in order to get access to your password. So we have passwords that are more difficult to guess, but we cannot really protect them from the human mistakes. So what can I do now to protect my sites? So is it a battle that is lost in advance? No, I don't want to give up all that easily. In fact, when I wanted to protect access to my website, to my machines, I was thinking really inside the box and not out of the box. And we have various mechanisms for authentication. So we often rely only on passwords, but we can also use two-factor authentication. So I will, for instance, use OTP, where I use one password that is my password plus a password that is changing every time. So for this, you probably know, for instance, if you are accessing a VPN, you are using a hardware token that will generate a random suite of numbers that you will use additionally to your password. or the other solution for two-factor authentication is the use of smart cards. So smart cards can take various formats. So you can see smart cards looking like credit cards, which are inserting into a reader, a smart card reader. But it can also look like a USB token that you will simply insert in your computer. And the advantage of smart cards is that in order to gain access to the system with your smart card, you need to both possess the physical token and also know the PIN that will allow you to use this token. So it is a solution, but I am simple sysadmin. Maybe it will be difficult to deploy such a solution. I know nothing about smart cards and so on. So if you are a sysadmin, you probably are familiar with identity management solution. And the specific solution that I will be talking about here is FreeIPA. So it is available upstream. And it allows to centralize authentication. So you can store all your users, all your hosts inside a single server. The source can be the identity server, so the Linux server, which is the IDM server, or the source can also be inside Active Directory. On this server, you can store the passwords, the certificates, the smart cards, OTP tokens, and it allows you to access your systems with a single sign-on because it is a solution that is based on Kerberos. The other advantages of our identity management solution are centralized authorization. So with authentication, I am proving to the system that I am really the person I claim to be. But with authorization, you are able to define who is allowed to access which machines, or who is allowed to access which services, and so on. So it's finer grained. You can define host-based access controls, sudo rules, a set of privileges, etc. And we also have other features that are important in identity management world. But the main thing for this talk is really the smart card authentication. So I will try to describe you how it is working when you insert a smart card into your reader. So the smart card authentication can be used if you want to access your system, I mean to log in, for instance, to use a console login or a GNOME login. But it can also be used for SSH access to your machine. Or it can also be used, for instance, if you want to authenticate to a website. So in a free IPA topology, you deploy a server, so where you install the server bits and where you configure the server bits. So the free IPA server has access to a database of users and groups. It is inside a LDAP directory server. And the client where you want to access. On this client, you need to configure FreeIPA client packages. So if you want to, for instance, to log into the console of this FreeIPA client, you will insert your token. And a set of checks will be done before you can actually connect to the machine. So inside your smart card, you have a private key and a certificate. And one of the first steps will be to check that the user knows the PIN so that he is allowed to access the private key and then use the certificate. So one of the first check is to prompt for the PIN, then you enter your PIN. Then the system will perform local checks on the certificates. So for instance, is my certificate trusted? Is it still valid? If the certificate contains OCSPA extensions, we will also be able to contact another server that will answer, for instance, if the certificate has been revoked or if it is still valid. And when all those local checks and I would say primary checks are done, in order to access resources inside our client, a certificate is not enough. In fact, we are living in a POSIX world. So we need a user ID in order to launch processes, to access files, etc. So we need to map the content of the certificate that is stored on the token with a user ID. So in order to do that, the FreeIPA client will contact the server and will provide him with the content of the certificate. When the server gets the content of the certificate, he will perform an internal search in the LDAP server database in order to find a matching user. And once he has found this user, we tell that the certificate is mapped to a user entry. And this user entry will provide a user ID and possibility to find to which groups the user is a member of. So once the user is found, the FreeIPA client considers that the client is authenticated. And the cherry on the cake, I would say, is that once the user is authenticated in FreeIPA client, he is also able to automatically obtain a Kerberos DGT. So this means that he will be able to use single sign-ons for all his other applications. So I was a little bit quick and didn't really explain how the mapping between the user and the certificate is done inside the server. So in the first step, I will explain how it was working in RHEL before 7.4 and in FreeIPA before 4.5. So inside the key, we are storing a certificate. So on the right of the screen, you can see the content of the certificate as a certificate blob. So it's only binary data. And in order to map this to a user, in fact, you remember I told you that the users are stored in a LDAP server. So it is possible for the server to make an internal search where he is extracting the content of the certificate and trying to find a user which contains exactly the same content in the user certificate field, in the user certificate attribute. So it's really a simple LDAP search where we are matching user certificate attribute with the content of the certificate. So it's simple, but it means when the admin wants to match user with a certificate, he needs to extract the certificate from the smart card in order to provision the value in the user entry. So when you create hundreds or thousands of users, you can imagine that each time a user comes in with a new key, you have to extract, then provision. So it's quite a painful process. So it's also painful when the smart card is lost, because if the smart card is lost or stolen, you have to revoke the certificate, but you also need to issue a new certificate and then update the LDAP entry with a new certificate, etc. So this process is a burden for the system administrator. And finally, the last limitation of this mechanism is that In RHEL 7.4, the certificate could be mapped to only one user entry. So if there were two or three users with the same certificate in the LDAP database, we were not able to disambiguate and to find which user really wanted to authenticate. So because of those limitations, we introduced what we are calling flexible mapping in RHEL 7.4 and in IPF 4.5. So with flexible mapping, here I am showing the content of a certificate, not as a blob entry, but as you can see it when you use, for instance, OpenSSL tool to show the content of the certificate. So the certificate is containing a number of fields, and the most important ones are the issuer and the subject. And we could imagine, instead of mapping the certificate to user with the whole content, we could imagine a mapping that would use only a part of the certificate. So here, we are defining what we call a mapping rule, where the user will extract the issuer and the subject from the certificate and perform a search inside the LDAP database, which tries to map issuer and subject to a specific user. So we can see that we are using a different attribute inside the LDAP entry with a specific format. So you can see that we are extracting issuer and subject and trying to map those values to values in the IPSert map data attribute. But this is only an example. In fact, you could define a large variety of mapping rules. And once you decide of a mapping rule, you just need to provision the user entry with values that will be fulfilling the search filter. So the big advantage is that an administrator is able to provision the user entry even before he knows the whole content of the certificate. So if you have rules for which when you have a new user, you know that the subject of his certificate will always have the same format, and only, for instance, the CN equal will change, you are already able to write this IPSert map data value inside its user entry. So you can provision it in advance. And if the certificate, if the token is lost, if you recreate a new certificate, obviously the content, the blob will be different. It will have a different serial number, etc. But the issuer and subject will not change. So you do not need to change the content of the attribute on the LDAP server side. So one of the enhancements we also added was that in FreeIPF 4.5, it is possible to map multiple users to a single certificate. So for instance, I am a sysadmin. Sometimes I want to log in with my token as a sysadmin role, but sometimes I just want to log in as a standard user and I don't want to have access to everything. So I can have two different user entries which are both using the same certificate, but when I log in, I will simply need to specify a different login and use the same PIN, in fact. And the last thing that we added was the PK init support. So as I said, it was a cherry on the cake. So when you authenticate, you are able to get a TGT ticket and use a single sign-on after that. So now it's time for your questions.
Does this require deployment of secure DNS, for instance, to avoid DNS hijacking attacks, stuff like that?
It does not require DNS. In fact, inside FreeIPA, mm-hmm. You are free either to deploy the DNS solution with FreeIPA or to use your own DNS server. So it's really free. It's not a requirement.
But if your infrastructure is unsecure and you set up this ivory tower, it doesn't make a lot of sense.
Yeah, well, but this is using SSL connections to the server, so it doesn't matter whether. Mm-hmm. The only thing you can do is that now the server can actually hijack the connection.
Mm-hmm. So, by the way, I didn't tell you, but if you ask good questions, I have some t-shirts for you, so please ask. So yeah.
Thank you.
Yes?
Does this integrate with Active Directory?
So yes, you can integrate with Active Directory. So when the user entries are stored in Active Directory, you have two choices, in fact. So sometimes you are able to modify the data in Active Directory because your sysadmin is allowed to access it. So in this case, you can provision the certificate inside Active Directory. But if it's a different team that is managing the AD server, you are also able to use what we are calling ID view. And in fact, the attributes are stored inside FreeIPA server instead of being stored in Active Directory. So you are also able to match the certificate, but with the value that is stored inside FreeIPA server. So other, yeah?
What are the hardware requirements for FreeIPA for a small company?
So if you look at the official documentation, you can find it. It really depends on the number of user entries, etc. But in our lab, we can deploy it easily on virtual machines. So it's not that greedy, I would say. It really depends on the number of entries that you will have inside your server.
Thank you.
So, yes?
With the flexible hacking, let's say that the old certificate is compromised, stolen, or whatever. If you generate a new one for the user, the old one would still match the value stored in the ITA database in the LDAP attribute. So do you perform some CRL checks or OCSP or something that the certificate is not revoked?
So we would need to revoke the certificates. And as I said in the beginning, when you insert the smart card, there are OCSP checks. So if the certificate is revoked, even if we are using flexible mapping, it will detect that it is revoked and it will not allow to process further. So maybe we still have some time for other questions, but I'm out of t-shirts now. So in fact, you can disable the OCSP check. We are relying on SSSD for that, and there is a setting inside SSSD.
A default configuration of ITA enforces OCSP.
Yeah?
So are there any software solutions that you like put on a phone or a device that are there any software solutions put on a phone, like an Android device or an iOS device, to simulate smart data and work with PIPs?
So, in this case, you would authenticate using the certificate rather than using the smart card feature.
Yeah, if there was some kind of like, plug it via USB and
So
you actually can try.
Yes.
Because on the phones that have on the go, USB on the go, they might be able to actually accept the smart card. So,
you know, I think the question was otherwise. If you can, if you can make your smartphone to behave like a smart card. If there is a project. I know you can,
yes.
But you probably don't want to.
Yes, but you need to have an infra that could use your SIM card. Like that. We do have this in Finland, for example, on a wide scale, operators provide this service, and you are able to authenticate to a statewide message bus, or whatever is the bus that all the, actually almost all banks and shops are using that to authenticate you, to prove that you are who you are. When you log in there, they can use this service, which is painted by your mobile operator, who basically in charge to document that you are who you are. But they use the SIM card certificate and the SIM card to complete.
So you are using the SIM card.
Yeah. Theoretically, this can be plugged in into Chrome and Firefox on Android as the ACS11 module. So theoretically, a browser on your phone might utilize that. I'm not sure about any. Let's say SSH clients on Android phone that would be able to utilize that, but if there would be TKCS11 interface, then I don't see any big deal of making it work. There was a talk today by Jakub Jelen about the OpenSC project that does exactly that, abstracting the access to hardware. Could work on the Android as well.
So if you are interested, we have a lot of resources on the web, so the project documentation, the Forge. Of course, you can contribute to the project because it's open source, and we welcome all contributions. And you can also use the mailing list. We are quite active, and we will be happy to help you. Thank you.